Welcome to the CRD in Context. My first guest today is Victoria City Councillor Margaret Lucas. Thanks for your time today, Councillor. Appreciate you coming in.
Thank you for having me.
So you were last on the show about two and a half years ago, and you were a newly elected city councillor.
Yes.
So over the past 2 years and plus, what have been your biggest learnings?
Wow, it's been a tremendous learning curve, actually, coming in from a business background where I have actually never worked for government in any form, municipal, provincial, or federal. So truly understanding how government works has been a very big learning curve for me. We do things, I believe, at a much quicker pace
in
the private sector. We have that ability. Having to have more patience with process, and has been a learning process.
Okay, so what about the biggest surprises? What's sort of taken you back the most about coming in from the private sector and now working in your current role as a councillor?
Well, I'm not used to having to report out to 82,000 people. I report to one boss. And now there are constituency residents in Victoria who want to know exactly what is going on and how it's happening. And so being able to do your job and pay attention to those 82,000 people has been interesting.
So 82,000 bosses.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
So right now, the Victoria City Council is calling on some of your colleagues on Victoria City Council are calling for a province to immediately impose a 15% non-resident buyer's tax on property in Victoria.
Yeah.
And you've said that you're waiting to see more evidence in jurisdictions such as Vancouver and most recently Toronto to see what sort of evidence comes in those jurisdictions. So what are your primary concerns right now about imposing such a tax?
Well, I have a lot of concerns around it. I think that are we calling it a foreign buyer's tax or are we calling it a Chinese buyer's tax? It seems to me that most people are focusing on that, and that makes me very, very uncomfortable. I also think that that it possibly is one tool in the toolbox, but I believe that we have to put in a tremendous amount more safeguards to protect, because think about somebody who has been coming into Vancouver and they're paying between $1 million and $2 million for a house. Do you think 15% is really going to prevent them from purchasing? I don't think so. I think there are loopholes in our Revenue Canada with that we allow foreign buyers to come in. They have young, I call them children, but they may be 19 years old and they're living in these big houses in Vancouver and they're called the principal residence so that they're not having to pay capital gains when they sell. They have first-time home buyers. Those are the things that, to me, are more of what we need to do than just to say, here, put a 15% buyer's tax, a foreign buyer's tax on this, and it's going to solve all our problems. My biggest thing is what I believe it's supply and demand, and supply and demand in our rental units and in our housing is strictly what I believe is the problem.
In terms of not enough supply.
Not enough supply.
Demand.
So then the prices can go up. If you take a look at our rental at 0.5% vacancy, that makes it very, very open to people to be able to say, I want $1,500 or $2,000 a month, versus if you're at 3 to 4% vacancy rental, you don't have that same ability to do that.
Yeah, but there are capacity to build more apartment buildings is there. But when it comes to this, sort of widely sought after single family dwelling, there really isn't in terms of quickly meeting that demand, because that's a unique product requiring, a substantial
Absolutely.
Amount of land, and we don't have that much land.
Well, we've got about $80 million worth of building going on at the moment. And within 2 years, we're going to have between 800 and 900 more living units. And that's half condo, half rental. I don't know exactly half, but there's a combination there. That is going to take a big chunk out of our market. And that's difficult because we have to wait 2 years. But there's more in the books and there's more going to come on board. But we went through a period of time where there wasn't enough building going on for the demand that was coming into Victoria. So we are behind. I don't think any of us realized that there was going to be this growth in Victoria over the past 3 or 4 years. I think census told us there was 5,000 people that came into Victoria. And so here's now our challenge with transportation, with housing. There's all sorts of things that are hitting us, but what are the good things, right? We have the lowest unemployment rate in the country.
Yeah, there are many, you know, like you say, positive benefits to it. The one article I was reading about this home buyer's tax and making it fair. I mean, like you say, maybe, not maybe, but the predominant, origin of buyers of these houses in Vancouver are going to be, wealthy offshore Chinese. Mm-hmm. And as you say, you don't want it to be seen as a head tax.
No, from, I don't. I'm concerned about that.
From days gone by. So you're just going to wait and make sure that whatever we do, this is only one tool in our toolbox.
Absolutely. I believe the biggest problem is the supply and demand. And I believe that always solves the problem down the road. And it's just difficult getting down there.
So it's a matter of time if the supply is cranked up.
Exactly.
So you don't think there's anything unique about Victoria that's going to make it such a destination of choice that you're literally almost going to never catch up with supply?
No, because our latest report that I had from the Real Estate Board, and this is for the CRD, so it was greater, all of, not just Victoria, but greater Victoria. So there were 6,900 property transfers, and that was from June of last year to December 31st. And there was 294 that were foreign buyers. Mm-hmm. That couldn't possibly have taken that market to where it went. There's just so many other factors that are involved. It's one part of it. Okay. On 6,900 and only 294, that's 4.3% were foreign buyers.
Yeah, like you say, not enough.
Not enough yet in Victoria.
To make this big a difference.
We had, another big part that I heard regularly were that people were in-province buyers. So they were coming out of Vancouver, they were selling their homes for $2 million, coming to Victoria, and they were taking their money, buying $1 million house and putting $1 million in the bank. And they were also a part of our problem. So they wouldn't get the foreign buyer's tax, but they also did the same thing to our market. I'd love to know how many on that scale compared to the 294, how many were out of city?
Victoria, out of city.
Yeah.
So related to this is that Victoria City Council wants the authority to impose an extra tax on vacant or derelict buildings. So you supported the idea of taxing derelict properties.
Yeah.
But you didn't want to see, the quote was, neighbor pitted against neighbor. So why would the tax do that? Why would it?
Well, who's going to patrol it? Police don't have enough police as it is now. Bylaw officers.
So it's the enforcement.
Enforcement. The only way is by neighbors phoning in on you and saying, "Gee, I haven't seen Margaret Lucas for 2 months."
Was this derelict or vacant?
The vacant.
Okay.
I get the derelict.
So you supported derelict.
I did support derelict, but I do not with vacant.
Derelict is. It's easy.
It's easy. It's easy for us all to see.
Yeah.
But a vacant, that means neighbors are going to be phone, and I just don't think that builds community.
No. Okay. How do you measure
it? How do you measure it?
Emptiness.
What is that? You have to be away for 3 months. So what happens if, John, you're called away, your sick parent, and you're in Toronto? Do you get penalized for that?
Yeah.
I don't know how we do this.
Fair enough. The... Another issue that came up was an increasing number of concerns are being raised about the fairness of Victoria's 200-meter minimum distance between cannabis dispensaries. You're one of the city's downtown liaisons, and your email box apparently is overflowing.
Yes, it is.
Okay, so what are Victorians, what are Victorians and or would-be business owners most concerned about?
Well, I think how it's going to be monitored and controlled.
The allotment of permits.
That's right. Okay. And I mean, if you look at the licensed retail stores, they have very clear guidelines how far apart you have to be, so that you're not on every street corner having a licensed retail store. I think we need to adopt some of the similar rules around distance apart from each other as we do with cannabis shops.
Is this any retail store or just
no? The license,
type?
So a liquor store.
Oh, gotcha.
So a licensed retail store is a liquor store,
yeah.
And they are not on every street corner. There are clear guidelines how far apart we have to be from each other,
right.
And you cannot come into the middle of that. So I am fully supportive of that being the same for cannabis shops.
Okay, but apparently there's still room for like up to 40 or 50.
Yes.
Even with the 200-meter minimum distance, then that could support, if they're all spaced exactly that far apart, could support 40 or 50 licensed
and
cannabis
dealers. As in part of the business community, I hear from them regularly, and they do have big concerns about that, as do I. I mean, I don't know how we, and all of this can change, John. This is the problem. We still have not seen things out of the federal government. Will they be putting in rules that are going to be significantly harder and further apart? There could be stuff that we don't even know about down the road yet. So we had a problem. We have tried to be proactive in managing it. But what happens in next spring, summer, when the federal government brings out their guidelines is yet to, we don't know that yet.
Well, it seems that the Fed's guidelines are already out, and it seems that they are more or less saying, okay, provinces now and cities, over to you.
Well, yeah, but like I say, none of that has truly come in because the province hasn't weighed in yet, which we won't know till after this election. And that's why I'm saying we tried to be proactive. But, I think that it will be monitored as we go along. At this point, that you have to go through the rezoning process, and that's expensive. Mm-hmm. And there are guidelines that people have to follow that they can't meet. So that's going to weed out a fair amount of stuff as well.
Well, the concern that I was reading about in the paper is that when two, applicants apply and they want to set it up in less than 200 meters apart, and they're kind of, okay, here's my application, and then a week later somebody says, here's my application, or even they come through the door at the same time, how do you say, okay, we're going to process this one faster and then the other one?
It's a first serve, first come basis.
So first come, first serve.
Yep. And that's no different than what the licensed retail stores, the liquor stores, were when we first started to apply in 2002 to the provincial government. It strictly was a first come, first serve basis. And it was whoever followed the rules, like for us at the hotel, there were clear guidelines that we had to have to get that license. And it was first come, first serve.
So, Victoria City Councillors acknowledged that urban deer might become an issue in the city, but they don't want to be the ones to deal with it because they see it as a provincial jurisdiction. And I think it was you who said that I think this is our issue, but the solution is not ours.
That's right.
So we don't have the time. We don't have the money. We don't have the staff to deal with this. It's a provincial issue. But at the same time, Oak Bay, in a similar kind of situation, has put up, I think, $20,000 towards addressing the issue in Oak Bay, and that $20,000 was matched by the province. So why wouldn't Victoria be willing to sort of take a similar approach?
Well, I think we don't have $20,000. We have a very tight budget. We have a lot more challenges that we face every day than Oak Bay does. I just don't think that we need to take on any more stuff than we already have in the city of Victoria. We find the province and the feds download on us all the time. And are we going to just take one more thing on that we can't afford to do? I don't think $20,000 is anywhere near what is required to solve that problem in Oak Bay, even if they did get some matching funds. They have problems with deer in Oak Bay still. So I just don't think it's something that we can take on at this time.
So is that whole issue going to be better dealt with by like a regional plan? Yeah,
the
regional
conservation
funding?
Officers, and that's the Ministry of Environment, that's province.
All province.
And it's as far as I'm concerned, that's their role and they need to do something.
Okay. So there's a suggestion that an exemption to the city's streets and traffic bylaw be put into place so that tickets will not be issued to people who are sleeping in their cars and when the vacancy rate falls below 3%. Well, it hasn't been below 3% in Lord knows how long. I don't know, 20 years or something, 25 years. So where are you on this issue? Why is the rate, why not link it to, you know, available homeless shelters as opposed to vacancy rates?
I don't like it in general.
Okay.
I find it a very difficult. I get that we have working folks, we have construction workers who are living in the cars, not because they can't afford a place, but because they just can't find a place. But where are the washroom facilities? You know, I had people call me. I was on one of the radio stations, and they said, well, why don't they just take the upper floors of a parkade? Oh, great. We're complaining right now in downtown Victoria of not having any parking, and we're now going to take a whole floor of upper parkades without washrooms, without shower facilities, without laundry facilities. And to me, this is not a solution. We need more housing, and I know that I don't have the perfect answer, but right now the province has, with the feds, put in, we've got about $90 million right now that has been given into the CRD. We've got BC Housing that has bought the Ingraham Hotel. They've got just bought the Tally Ho. There are stuff that's coming, and no, it's not quick enough and fast enough, but I think that sleeping in cars is a band-aid solution.
And is it a solution that it seems to be currently dealt with in a relatively light touch? Like the officers aren't issuing tickets to, you know, certain individuals. Does it require this kind of legislated approach?
I don't think it does. But staff are going to, what was asked is for staff to come back with a report to us with the benefits and the risks associated with this. So we will wait to hear what they have to say.
Okay. Well, listen, it's really nice for you to come back after
Thank
two
you.
Years and share your insights. And I really appreciate the time that you've given us today.
Thank you.
It was a
pleasure.
That concludes this segment of the CRD in Context. My next guest today is Oak Bay Mayor and CRD Director Nils Jensen. Mayor, thanks for coming in today.
Well, thanks for inviting me, John.
Appreciate
Great to
time.
Be here.
Appreciate your time. So in February, you chaired the biannual meeting of the BC Mayor's Caucus. And so how many mayors would attend from around the province?
We get about a third of them.
Okay.
We meet twice a year. That's the bi and the annual.
Yeah.
And we meet, the other meeting is generally at our larger conference, Union and British Columbia Municipalities, when all of the mayors, all of the councillors get together once a year in September.
Right.
And you know, we recognize, and part of the raison d'etre for the BC mayors getting together kind of on their own is we are, constitutionally, so to speak, the only directly elected leader when you think about it. So federal government, there's no direct leader vote. Same thing with the provincial government. So we at the local government level really are in a bit of a different category than other
right.
leaders throughout Canada. And it's fashioned along the lines of the big city mayors. But in our case, we welcome all of the mayors from across BC, and you know, we often discuss issues of mutual interest, particularly because one of the things that we have to do as mayors is chair meetings. And as we know, we can see around, particularly in the island, sometimes the mayor has certain challenges with councillors or vice versa. And how do you go about doing that?
That's one of the topics that was addressed?
Well, it usually addressed in the networking, but one of the things that we did this year, this is the first time it's been held.
You're sort of indirectly referring to the Nanaimo situation?
Well, absolutely. I mean, that's an issue that because you don't have party discipline like they do at the federal provincial level, how do you deal with difficulties like that? So that's something that we talk about, but mostly in the quieter networking kind of format. But what we tried to focus on this year at the meeting in Oak Bay was what's important to the communities throughout British Columbia, and how do the mayors see that? And then in an effort to get, during the provincial election, to get the parties to look at the issues that have been identified as important to local politicians. So prior to our meeting, we did a survey of all mayors across British Columbia. We got about a third of them replied, not necessarily the same ones that came to the meeting. But so we asked them, what's important? What are the leading issues in your community? And then we we kind of listed those out, and we had discussions around them and what's important to the mayors.
And number one was the state of public infrastructure and its financing.
Very much so. We identified a number of big topics. One was the public infrastructure. What do we do with it? How do we finance it? We're not unusual here in Oak Bay or in the Victoria area. The older communities all have infrastructure challenges. It's often called the infrastructure deficit across Canada. And we've had, for instance, a gas tax fund over the years that has supplied somewhere in the region of about $10 to $12 billion. We're expecting more. So how is it that, how do we get the provinces to the province to discuss this, and what is their role in supporting the local government's infrastructure challenges?
So in terms of the, just bump it up to the federal government, in terms of its new infrastructure bank that it has brought into play. So it's going to involve the private sector. So in terms of having a role to play in funding municipal infrastructure, replacement, repair, upgrades and whatnot, what role do you see for the private sector?
Well, often some of these programs, particularly under the federal Conservative government, they insisted on private enterprise being involved, and also in many instances the public-private partnerships,
Right. Which
can often be beneficial. It seems certainly the current federal government doesn't put as much emphasis on the need to have a public-private partnership, although they can bring benefits. This is a community issue. And the people that are involved in the community, the federal government, the provincial government, the local government, and businesses. Mm-hmm. And I think those four have to work together. And what we look for in the local government is a greater share of the taxes that are collected by the province and the federal government to be shared with local governments, because that's where things are done. That's where the roads are done, and the bridges, and the water, and the sewer. It all falls to us. And traditionally, we have an archaic system of collecting taxes at the local government. Property taxes based on assessed value. It's very regressive, and particularly for small communities that don't have industry or shopping centers, it's very difficult to become sustainable based on just residential property taxes. That's why it's necessary for those four entities to come together and work together.
Well, one of the big changes, as I understand, that Oak Bay has made, I guess more recently, is to address those issues through a utility charge as opposed to a property tax charge.
Well, on sewer and water, that's right. And I think that's a growing trend, John.
Which is expensive.
Which is expensive.
Yeah.
And, you know, this was very much highlighted. You may recall the Walkerton tragedy in Ontario. And what the commission that looked at that came to the conclusion is that the water infrastructure, the stuff you don't see under the ground, was left to deteriorate because it was supported by taxes. And it's a simple human dynamic. Local politicians, if they have a choice between replacing something that people don't see in the ground versus getting a new police car or a new fire engine, of course they're going to take the fire engine, particularly if it's close to an election. So one of the things that the Walkerton Inquiry did for Ontario is to say you should not, and in fact the law was changed, you cannot fund water infrastructure through taxation. It has to be run as a utility model, so user pay, so separating it from the tax structure. We started doing that in Oak Bay over 10 years ago. We've had it very fortunately here in the CRD. I was chair of the water board for 12 years. Even preceding that, we ran the water board on a utility model, not on a tax model. So it was all user pay. And as a result of that, John, the CRD has a state-of-the-art, leading-edge water, wholesale water supply system and purification system. So we're very fortunate. What we also discovered in Oak Bay, though, is that it should also apply to sewage pipes under the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's part of it. And most communities now in the CRD, they run their sewer and water based on a utility model. And that's one way to ensure that that infrastructure is continually renewed.
Okay, so two things that we've brought up here. One is getting the provincial government on side to, you know, lend a hand to municipalities. So without going into a lot of detail here, for the upcoming provincial election, a couple of weeks, is a municipality better off being in a government-held riding or not, or does it matter?
You mean during an election or after an election?
After the election.
I think there's no question that the reality of the human dynamic is if you have a sitting member of a government in your riding, you're going to get perhaps more attention than if you're in the opposition. So it's and you know what, to be very frank about it, which this program's all about frankness, isn't it? To be very frank about it, when we had a cabinet minister in the provincial government representing us, same thing when we had a cabinet minister in the federal government representing us, we had, if I could put it this way, more intelligence as opposed to regarding where the granting funds opportunities were. And we could pick up the phone and find out what are the grant possibilities in this area or that area, and could you help shepherd that through the morass of bureaucracy. Many of these things are not decided in the end.
Yeah.
By the politicians are decided based on criteria for the public service. But to get your application in front of them, sometimes, of course, you're assisted by people on the inside knowing how the system works.
But you have a leg up in the, as you say, the shepherding process.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, give you an example. We had issues to do with when I was head of the water board, to do with our ultraviolet plant, leading edge plant, biggest in North America at the time. This was water purification. And we had some issues as to how we were going to get that approved by the Ministry of the Environment. Well, I can tell you that Mr. Anderson, who was a minister of the environment at that point, was extremely helpful in ensuring it was finished in a timely way, the assessment. And so we were able to build it on time and on budget with his assistance. And so that is important.
Okay. No, it makes perfect sense. One of the other things that came up there was sewage. And in terms of the front end of the CRD's sewage treatment process, the McLaughlin Point treatment plant has been finally finalized with respect to the front end of the whole system. And you've been a very, very strong proponent of the McLaughlin Point site for years. So in that site now having been formally adopted and construction ready to begin, you know, in months, how do you end up feeling? Do you like you feel vindicated? Do you feel fortunate? Do you feel one of the lines that came up, do you feel thankful to Esquimalt for taking one for the team?
Well, no, they didn't take one for the team. This is, it's not a matter of vindication or not vindication. It's a matter of, I think, coming to the right decision. So after 8 years of study, there was a decision made on McLaughlin Point going forward, which was then barred by the Esquimalt vote. And then, you know, at that point, I sat back and they say, okay, well, let's start a new process. Let's look for other sites. Let's look for other opportunities. Mm-hmm. We went through that for a year, and I was happy to let that go. I wasn't an advocate of one site or another after that. After that, it became very clear, and McLaughlin was not in the mix.
You weren't an advocate during the process.
No, but that's once right. It was finished, I was very open-minded. Look at everything, look at everywhere. After that process, John, it became very clear that the new sites, if I can call them that, were $250 million more than the original McLaughlin site.
Okay.
So at that point, I went to the CRD and I said, it's time we put McLaughlin back on. And people were running around as if the earth had opened up and we're all going to fall into an abyss. I think one mayor said, this will mean war in the CRD. And the mayor said, this is bizarre, it's weird to put McLaughlin back. But at the end of the day, when we asked another independent panel to look at what is the best site and value for money and from an environmental point of view, they came to the same conclusion. And so we'd essentially gone from 8 year study to a 1 year study to letting an independent panel look at it. And every time we've come to the conclusion that it is McLaughlin is the best site, most economical. And it shouldn't be forgotten in all of this process that it was Esquimalt who first put that site mm-hmm. on the table. It was their suggestion that we should start, the CRD should start looking there. So I just became, at the end of the day, I just became the vehicle to put it back on the table. And it wasn't easy going, John, I can tell you that.
Oh, no,
I took a lot
file.
Of slings, a yeah. lot of arrows, but in the end of the day, my happiness is, and we got the best environmental plant, we got the most economical plant. So that, I think, is good for all of us. Whether you live in Esquimalt or Oak Bay or Saanich, this has been the best result. So I'm happy for that. And I think all of us in the seven core communities should feel that way.
Okay. Another issue out there is secondary suites. So Oak Bay Council has instructed staff to report on the process of regulating the estimated 800 illegal suites in Oak Bay. But I seem to recall that about 15 years ago, when Victoria legalized secondary suites, Oak Bay didn't show a lot of interest in it. But now they have. And in terms of regulating them, what's the end goal? Is it to reduce their number? Is it to maintain the current number of 800? Is it to increase for densification? Bring up to code? What's the goal here?
And that goal has, there are various goals, and you've touched on some of them. One is to ensure that they're safe.
Okay.
We want to ensure that these secondary suites that, where people live in, a lot of students live in, are safe from a health and fire point of view. So that's one. Two is we want to ensure that these suites don't change the nature of our streetscapes and our neighborhoods. So how are we going to regulate them? I know you were involved many years ago, and we actually, if you recall, when Oak Bay, about 7-8 years ago, we started looking at this.
Yes.
We have been looking at it since that time. I ran a committee for a while, and we looked to you as an expert witness from the Gonzales. And so we're facing the same kind of issues that you had in your neighborhood. How do you deal with parking and noise and extra people? How do you apportion the cost of secondary suites? So that's going to be a challenge. We want to ensure that our community remains intact. in the way it is, because I think people move to Oak Bay because there's a high quality of life, and it's natural beauty, it's serenity, all of those reasons. And we want to make sure that when we proceed on secondary suites, we don't jeopardize all the qualities of life. And I think that can be done. Other communities have seen it can be done. But and it's not a matter of just densifying for the sake of densifying. It's also a matter of recognizing the cost of housing in Oak Bay is quite astronomical. Mm-hmm. And when you look at young families moving in or seniors living in their homes, it's very difficult sometimes to make ends meet. Secondary suites provide a mortgage helper. Had a young lawyer some years ago ask me, he'd love to move into Oak Bay. He couldn't afford a house without a secondary suite in it. At that time, they were illegal. So he moved he decided to buy another community. I've heard seniors on fixed income with a big house who would like to have a secondary suite in order to help their income. They would like it. Other seniors would like nursing assistants to live in a secondary suite in their home so they can extend the amount of time before they have to move into assisted living. So there's all kinds of good reasons for that.
Lots of benefits there.
There's lots of benefits to a community, bringing younger families in and providing more affordable housing.
Right. Mayor, 18 and a half minutes goes by very, very quickly.
I thought we were just halfway through it, John. Come on now.
I hate to tell you, but we've run out of time. But I really appreciate you coming.
Thank you, John.
Thanks so much.
It's been great. Thank you.
Thanks so much for your time. That concludes this segment of the CRD in Context. My final guest today is Jack Phillips. Jack is with the Society of Living Illicit Drug Users, called SOLIT for short.
Yep.
Jack, thanks for your time today.
Thanks for having me, John.
Appreciate you coming in. So for our viewers, can you just give us a quick overview of what SOLIT does?
Sure. At SOLIT, we provide health education. We're community advocates. We run a street outreach team, which is a mobile needle exchange, naloxone training. Basically, services that are oriented towards a street entrenched population.
Okay, and just tell our viewers what naloxone does.
Naloxone is the antidote for opiate overdose.
Right, okay. And your website says that SOLIT challenges personal and systemic injustice by promoting practical harm reduction strategies in our communities and in our individual lives. So again, what does that mean? Give me an example of systemic injustice.
I'll go to practical harm reduction first, okay? Because what we want to do there is we want to deliver services that are actually attainable by the person that you deliver the service to. A lot of people don't have any kind of health care, primary health care, and by engaging them where we go right out in the street to meet people, their first connection is that point of trust with another peer who's lived that experience with them,
So how much does having lived that experience, I mean, I would imagine that it bumps the trust quotient up fairly quickly.
Yeah, it really does make all the difference because for example, when I go out on street outreach, if I offer somebody help, they well know that help has come from a place of experience. I'm not trying to bring them to a place that may not want to serve them in a way they want to be served.
So you basically vouch for the place that you want to take them.
And we try to make sure that the services are available that people like can attain. If you bring somebody who has multiple health barriers and are trying to get them primary care, that's probably not, that probably won't work because there are many complications to getting that primary care. Mm-hmm. So service delivery to people where they're at is crucial, and then them having the experience of dealing all together in the same community for years, it just builds that trust, yeah, of service delivery.
So in terms of services, I would imagine the most crucial service is to somebody who suffered an overdose is to make sure that they live and don't die. I mean,
yeah.
I guess that's the most
Yeah, a few months back when we were first tasked to start the naloxone distribution program, which is
who asked you?
The BC CDC.
Which?
Public Health.
Oh, Public Health, okay.
And we were called by them in VHA and the Health Authority and asked to immediately go out, because we have a large street outreach team, and start distributing naloxone peer-to-peer and training peer-to-peer. Like, for example, when I go and train professionals in a setting, they have a different level of uptake with what's in naloxone kits, how it's used. It's a more in-depth training. Somebody who's entrenched in drug lifestyle already understands what the naloxone kit does, basically how it's used, and so you go through a quicker training and then have them redistribute naloxone to other people who need that. And so the goal was to have the streets filled with naloxone so that if you actually needed it, you could just yell and somebody would have it within an earshot of you.
And know how to use it.
And know how to use it, of course.
So insiders were a quicker uptake in terms of training than outsiders.
And of course, it was quicker to go to a neighborhood that had a lot of activity in it than try to wait for people to come to a storefront or someplace to ask for training. It was just easier to go out into the community and train the people who needed the training, because ultimately they were the first responders. Even if they were lucky enough to have a telephone to call 911, that they still had to make the first response. They had to rescue, breathe for that person, do the naloxone themselves. So it was most appropriate to make sure those people who would be the first responder were actually trained to respond.
So it's interesting. The health authority recognized your group as the go-to people, given the nature of the opioid overdose health crisis that we're facing in the community.
Well, it's. When you've lived that experience, it's easier to understand why people do what they do and the choices that they make, and it's easier to have just open, forthright conversation, which is honest. And I'm not interested in stopping somebody from using drugs, but I'm definitely interested in making sure every day that I see them.
Okay, so that for me is an important one. So ultimately, you don't take a position on whether or not you would like to see this person ultimately stop using drugs or not?
No, that's not a concern of mine. My only concern would be to help any person where they're at, just like, people with drugs get a bad rap, but
yeah.
If somebody was to go to the hospital and have lung cancer, nobody says, well, I'm not going to give you the treatment because you smoked for 50 years. That's just an accepted thing that you treat that person. And I have much the same attitude about helping people who are...
No, I understand that at the front end. First and foremost, help them, right? Once you've got them to a point where they're past this particular crisis, why wouldn't you want to help them to stop using drugs?
Honestly, I think the way the system is set up right now is just not effective at delivering that model. Like when somebody goes into detox, treatment, the way that those systems are set up, that has a very low success rate. I think it would be more prudent to immediately engage somebody where they're at. If their behavior is making them risk their life every day, then I would vote for them not having to risk their life every day via getting a prescription of legitimate drugs that you knew what was in them. Because once that person had engaged in that treatment for months, maybe gotten a house, regain community, family connections, the chance that they are going to make that choice themselves when they are ready to is what will save people.
So they talk about readiness, somebody who is ready to, quit using drugs. And so if I understand you correctly, if you want to get somebody ready to make that choice, then the way to do it is to, stabilize them, get them reunited possibly with some, family. Mm-hmm. And then, like you say, it has to be their choice.
Yeah.
But that route is going to be more likely to end in them making a choice to get off drugs.
Yeah, and really I just want people to improve the quality of their lives. Most people are not entrenched in addictive behavior for enjoyment. It's because of past trauma or other issues, right? So I'm much more in favor of just meeting people where they're at and delivering them the services that they can actually use.
Okay, they have the health authority has this group, have these, what they call assertive community teams?
ACT teams.
So you smile. So how do you interact? What caught my attention there is the word assertive. So when I read that, assertive community treatment ACT teams, well, maybe they are more assertive in guiding an individual to give up the life that they're involved in.
I gotta say, I've actually been under the supervision of the ACT team in the past, and I did not find that they were at all, and I don't speak to the people who run that service or the service that they have set up, but I just think that model is just not a legitimate way. Most of the time, honestly, the ACT team is spent making sure people take their medication, giving them $20 a day. These kind of things are not actually, like, I understand the use of that program, mm-hmm. but I just think it's not the most effective use of money being spent.
So in terms of money being spent, who funds you?
The Health Authority funds us, MAC Cosmetics funds us, and some of our money comes from our own people, okay. just to run the service.
But so the Health Authority, you know, funds the ACT teams, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it also funds Solid.
Of course.
And they're sort of two fairly different models of addressing.
Well, let's go to another thing we were tasked to do by the Health Authority, which was deliver naloxone training to supported housing facilities.
Right.
Most of these supported housing facilities had abstinence-based protocols before the initiation of this program, which was in December. So in a very short amount of time, we were tasked to go into a building which previously would have said, John, I'm sorry, you're not allowed to use here, and if you do use, I certainly can't see you. Now, most likely, that's going to end up with you dying in your room alone with no one's help.
Right.
Because you were told your behavior was bad, you were stigmatized, and you were asked to go to your room and hide it.
And stay invisible.
Right. So what we've tried to do is bring a harm reduction protocol to where we do something very simple, like in a common room, put supplies. We already know people are using in the building, so if we can get the staff to create an environment which is more safe for the people there, then the staff are having to deal with less naloxoning of people and less deaths within their building. So I think that just by the work we do, we've been able to illustrate in a short amount of time how a paradigm shift is necessary to try to tackle the problem we find ourselves in.
Yeah, the number of deaths, I don't know how accurate these figures are, but like back in 2015, in terms of opioid drug deaths was like around 20 people. Now we're last year, 2016, it was 66.
We've already had 30 people die just here in Victoria since the new year.
Okay, so 30 people just in the first 4 months.
Yeah, so the numbers are terrible, unfortunately. They continue to get worse no matter what kind of solutions we throw at the problem, which is why I always say, can we look to Portugal? Can we look to other countries where they've had decriminalization, legalization, and the drastic reduction in opiate use there, or any kind of drug use?
Yeah, so that's the model for you.
Totally.
Okay, so Portugal has basically, correct me if I'm wrong here, they've basically made any type of illicit drug available to people who want them, or how does it work?
Well, I think each country works a little differently.
Because they seem to be the most...
Well, that's the thing is, I think depending on which country, if we go to Portugal, a lot of people will say, well, they're too liberal. You know, if we look at other countries, you know, that have similar programs, I think we have to find a fit that works for us. I know that I'm personally a victim of a drug war that started many, many years ago that ended up with me being entrenched in hard drug use because of the criminality that my lifestyle was said to have been. When in fact, now we're on the verge of the legalization of a lifestyle which I was previously told was criminal.
In terms of marijuana legalization.
In terms of marijuana legalization, and having any kind of drug war, having somebody who's involved in the marijuana business be then put into a situation where they're going to live the penal experience, they're definitely going to meet. It's just a system that just breeds more of the same. And I think that there are a lot better uses for law enforcement than drug laws. Mm-hmm. There's certainly a large amount of violent offenders and predators like that they could be more well investigated and caught, and this could be turned into what it is, which is a health problem.
So legalizing the various drugs is, you know, like you said, varies from country to country to country. You have to find one that would work, you know, in Canada or British Columbia. Mm-hmm. But that generally is the road to go down.
Well, I think that it's difficult to see people who are so stigmatized every day by something so simple. Like nobody criticizes people for drinking coffee or drinking alcohol in a general sense, those things are accepted. I think we just have to have an honest check of ourselves as people. People like to have sex. People like to feel different feelings. That's going to lead to alcohol, drug use, whatever gives people relief. So I think to take a portion of things and say, well, this is illegal and not acceptable, and over here this is just a bad approach to take.
So to what degree, I mean, I read these figures of fentanyl-related deaths. There's more, the majority are amongst individuals who don't use injection drugs. They use what's called, you know, party drugs. So they're doing lines of cocaine on the weekend, maybe ecstasy or whatever. And they're totally unaware that it's been laced with fentanyl.
Yeah.
And these are individuals who've, you know, work during the week, hold down jobs, that is, like I say, recreation on the weekend.
Yeah.
And they are dying at a greater rate than sort of the stereotype injection drug user. So do you think that their deaths have brought greater attention to the overall fentanyl crisis?
I think in a way, of course, because each person is touched by a different story about a different segment of the community, but I think that is a good example of what we were just talking about, in the way that if more people were to die down in bars doing cocaine on the weekend, then maybe more people would come over to the side that I argue for of drug legalization, because I don't want to see anybody in any situation compromised in that way.
Yeah. The other one that caught that statistic caught my attention, and the other one was the resources that are being brought to bear overall on the issue. That, again, they just seem to have gone up considerably. Like I mentioned to you, I had Dr. Richard Stanwyck on the show a few months ago, and he began to outline the resources that are being brought to bear. Are they sufficient?
Just like all governments or all poor bureaucracies are slow moving, and if you're a frontline worker, I don't think the help could ever come fast enough.
Okay, so it's the speed of the delivery of the help. What about the raw number of dollars that have been allocated to this problem?
Like I say, I'm not sure if the dollars and cents is the issue. I think the whole overall...
Like you see, it's the model.
It's the model, right? Like how much money was spent on treatment beds, because that is viewed as an effective treatment, but if you look at the numbers, it's not. But it is a good election promise in order to get people to vote for you. But that millions of dollars spent on 100 beds could have been so much more effectively put into, imagine a building here locally, like let's say the Fernwood Community Center. I would love to have a safe consumption site that wasn't looked upon as a shooting gallery or a place where people just go for that. I would love for everybody to drive by and say, look at that great garden. What's that music that I hear over there? You know, and actually, because those are the things that would actually help people to recover in that situation if you gave them other options.
Yeah, it's quite a different model than as they say, they have a 21-bed, they have a huge wait list for a 21-bed detox unit at the Royal Jubilee Hospital.
Yeah,
And as you say, that model doesn't particularly result in a lot of success.
And that's for very, very simple reasons, too. That's a lockdown ward. I tell you, most people who go to detox smoke cigarettes. Once you're in there, you can't get out. So, John, you've been in the worst detox of your life. You're 3 days into a cold sweat, shaking, and you just need a cigarette. And as soon as you walk out that door, you can't come back for 3 weeks, and you got to make all those phone calls to get in again. So are you going to try to access that help? How many times?
Yeah.
That's a lot of wasted money for over not being able to have a cigarette.
Jack, a very interesting take on this. Listen, I wish we had more time, but we don't.
Well, thanks.
And I really do appreciate you coming in today and just explaining the model that you operate under. Thanks very much,
John.
For your time.
Thanks for having me.
Appreciate it. That concludes this segment of the CRD in Context.